In this video lecture, we'll learn how to create constructors, which are just special methods used to initialize new object instances of any class. Okay, let's get started. For starters, a constructor in a Java class is nothing but a method, but it's a very specific, special method. A constructor is the method that gets called when we instantiate a new object using the new keyword, as we've seen countless times before, as in these examples. For example, here we're creating a new string object in the formal way, and this string after the new keyword is a constructor of the string class. Similarly, here we're creating a default CS12 date with today's date parameters, and this CS12 date after the new keyword is the default constructor of the CS12 date class. The purpose of any constructor is to set up and initialize new object instances of its class. Constructor methods have a few special properties. Constructors carry the same exact name as their class, including the leading capital letter. Constructors virtually always have a public access specifier because we want the outside world to be able to create objects of their class type. Finally, and this is a key difference between constructors and regular methods, a constructor's interface has no return value, not even void. For example, in the CS12 date teaching class that I created, here is what the default constructor interface looks like. It has a public access specifier, followed by the constructor method name, which is identical to that of the class, followed by any input arguments within parentheses. But here for a default constructor, there are none. And then of course, the body of the method within braces. But as you can see, what this interface doesn't have is any return type, which is why this void is shown as crossed out. So a constructor is simply a method which bears the same name as its class. A constructor's purpose in life is to instantiate new objects of their class. When a new object comes into being using the new keyword, the instructions in the constructor which follows the new keyword are the first things that object sees in its life. At a bare minimum, the constructor should initialize all its instance variables to either specified values or else set them to recognizable, reasonable defaults. But recognize that a constructor is nothing but a special method containing instructions, so constructors can also perform any needed startup actions, call other methods within their class, or in general, do anything that any other Java method could do. Although I don't recommend this, it turns out that having a constructor is actually optional. If no constructors are provided, the compiler will automatically provide you one and set all the class instance variables to default values through auto-initialization, which we'll see next. So I guess it's kind of like a Miranda warning and having a lawyer appointed if you can't afford one. However, it's a good practice to always provide a constructor, and we'll consider it a course coding standard to provide one or more constructors and use them to explicitly initialize every instance variable so that we don't have to rely upon auto-initialization. One key difference between regular old variables such as we've seen and instance variables of the class is the idea of auto-initialization. Recall that anytime we've declared a variable in any method of any code we've written, we can't compute with or display that variable until its value has been initialized. Otherwise, we'll get a compiler error. Regular old variables can't be used unless you've explicitly given them some value. By contrast, instance variables of a class appear at the head of the file and outside any of the methods, and are subject to auto-initialization if they aren't explicitly initialized. All this means is that if our instance variables aren't explicitly assigned some starting value, auto-initialization will initialize them to these values: integer 0 for the integer data types, 0.0 for the floating point data types, the null character for a char, false for booleans, and a null for any type of object reference. Once again, although all instance variable data types have these fallback initialization values, the coding convention in this course will be to always explicitly initialize all our instance variables and not rely on these defaults. Here are simple starting versions of the two constructor forms we'll add to our person class next, and that we should always provide as the bare minimum for any classes that we write. The first one is a default constructor, and notice that it carries the same name as our class, accepts no input values, and contains no return type in between the public access specifier and the constructor name. A default constructor represents the quick and dirty, easy way to instantiate any new Java object. There's no thinking required here. The constructor itself sets some reasonable default values for every instance variable. What reasonable means is up to the designer, but these defaults should be clearly recognizable in some way. Here, I think it's pretty obvious that this is a starting default value. The second one is a full constructor. And again, notice that it carries the same name as our class and contains no return type in between the public access specifier and the constructor name. But this time, it takes one data type variable name pair for every instance variable we have and uses these inputs to explicitly initialize each instance variable. Remember that by our incremental design paradigm for building up this person class, we've currently only defined the one string instance variable first name, so we use our one input value to explicitly initialize that instance variable. In both cases, however, notice that there is no declaration needed here on the left-hand side for either first name, because this is our instance variable and it's already been declared at the head of our file, so now we're just initializing its value. Again, notice that constructors are simply small, simple methods bearing the same name of the class. These two examples represent the two extremes of constructors. A default constructor is the simplest way of instantiating an object, but gives us no control over the process. A full constructor takes a little more work, but it gives us full control over instantiating an object. For this course, we'll consider it our coding standard to always provide at least these two constructor forms, a default and a full constructor. While these two constructors may look trivially simple at this point for only one instance variable, we can probably look ahead and see where this is going. Once we get these simple versions in place for one instance variable, you can probably see that it will be very easy to scale these up and add all the other needed instance variables, which is exactly the approach we'll be taking a bit later on. Start simple, then add on to it. Having multiple like-name constructors like this illustrates an important object-oriented principle called overloading, which is a nice segue to our next topic. It's very common and very useful in object-oriented programming to have multiple versions of a method with the same name, a concept called overloading. Overloading simply gives us different ways of doing things. For example, if we're creating an object, we can either do it the quick and easy way by using a default constructor, or we can be very specific about the values we want by using a full constructor. And as we'll see later on, we can even have additional constructor forms than just those. When we're setting up overloaded constructors or any other methods, we must keep in mind that the different method interfaces must differ somehow in one or more of the following: the number of input arguments, the data types of the input arguments, and the order of the input arguments. In the first of these overloaded method examples, this first one clearly differs in the number of inputs, so this is fine. In the second example, the data type of the second argument is clearly different, so this too is fine. In the third example, we have the same two input argument types, but the order is swapped, so this too is fine. But in this fourth example, these interfaces are not sufficiently different, because even if we've swapped the two input names, the compiler sees nothing but an int and an int as inputs, so this would not even compile. So again, as a course coding standard, we'll always expect you to provide a default constructor taking no arguments and setting all instance variables to some sensible defaults, and a full constructor explicitly specifying all instance variables. Beyond that, you can provide any other constructors you wish as designer's choice, and it's often useful to provide some other alternate or shortcut forms. I don't know if you caught it or not, but there's one little thing about the prior example that just sort of bugs me. In the full constructor we just wrote, you can see that we're using two different variable names to refer to the same data quantity. Our input to the full constructor is a string called personFirstName, but all we're doing is simply transferring its value to the instance variable firstName. Two different names referring to the same single data quantity. I just find that kind of clumsy. Can we improve upon this somehow? Well, this is Java, so of course we can. As it turns out, all objects of the same class share one common copy of its methods someplace in memory. So any calls to those methods need to be able to differentiate which of multiple possible objects called them. Underneath the hood, it turns out that there is a Java keyword literally called this, which is an implicit parameter used in any method call. This is an object reference which refers back to the specific object which is trying to call the method. Put another way, the full name of any instance variable of the class is, really, this.varName. So what it means is that we can use this to differentiate between an instance variable name and the same name used as a method argument. Let's see how we can now improve our earlier full constructor. Here we see a slightly improved version of our earlier constructors. Remember, at this point we're starting out simple and implementing all the needed methods for just this one instance variable. Once we've got all the needed methods in place for one instance variable, we'll come back around and show how easy it is to extend this to all the other instance variables. For now, start simple, get something working, and then add onto it in stages. This is a much less error-prone approach to creating software. Notice that our default constructor takes no inputs, so there's no ambiguity in this instance variable assignment statement, and hence no change needed here. But for this full constructor, notice that we've changed the left-hand side instance variable into its full formal name using the this keyword. Now we can change the right-hand side variable name into the same one, and thus also in this interface. And now there's no ambiguity between first name as an input parameter and first name as an instance variable. Now we're referring to the same data using one common name. And this, no pun intended, just feels cleaner. This is how I'd like to see you implement all your instance variables if they also involve some input parameter of the same name. Please finish up by viewing the demo video for personphase3.java, where we'll demonstrate how to add these constructors to our prior person class, which will be the next step in building up our class. Okay, that's it for now in constructors, which are just special methods in a class which are used to instantiate and initialize new objects of their class.